So, this being said, let's take a look at our first example of the Mandela Effect, which is the movie from the Vampire Chronicles in which played Tom Cruise, Brad Pitt, Kirsten Dunst and Antonio Banderas. Do you remember the name of the movie? Let's see what happens if we search in Google. Interview with. As you can see, what first appears is we interview with a vampire. The fourth option is interview with the vampire. Now, if you remember correctly, then you remember the same thing that I remember, and that is interview with a vampire. Problem is, when you enter, you get the result, interview with the vampire. The algorithm of Google shows the first option, the most searched one. So there are many people that are searching for interview with a vampire. This is proven by Google. If we go further, we can see that the book also appears as an interview with the vampire. So, a question arises. Why would be the movie called Interview with a Vampire and the book Interview with the Vampire? Here we can see both the movie and the novel named Interview with the Vampire. But as you will see now, the author of the book, Anne Rice, and more people involved in the production of the movie say different.
Interview with the Vampire, the film you're about to see, is one that I love with all my heart. I couldn't take greater pleasure in recommending a movie to you. I remember the first time I saw this film. I wasn't in the theater and I wasn't with the big screen. I was in the privacy of my own home and I was watching it on videotape, just as you probably are going to do now. Warner Brothers, in a very unusual act of trust, had sent me an early tape of the film before the movie's release. This movie is not just about vampires, it's really about us. This is my new book, Memnoch the Devil. It's the fifth one in the Vampire Chronicles, and once again, Lestat is the hero, just as he was in Interview with the Vampire. He's my devil, my dark lover, my alter ego. Sometimes I think he's my
character very much, but Lestat, I mean, I actually can call him up like a vision from time to time, or he comes to me like a vision, you know, and he walked off, he truly left. There are no further tales for me to tell you, that's what he said.
Now, I don't want to give away too much within
sure.
my questions as well, but in your first vampire book, Interview with a Vampire, which was written near 20 years ago, at the end of that book, the vampires believe there is no God.
That's right.
There is no ultimate meaning to life's anguish.
That's right.
And in this, I'm wondering, over the 20 years, has your belief changed, and what triggered the change, if so?
I believe in a creator, and certainly not the
a
kind
single
of
creator?
Some force in the universe that has to do with love and organization and harmony and justice. But I can't say it's a deeply held belief. It's just a deep suspicion that there is. Atheism seems rather unconvincing to me now. It seems rather silly. You know, I'm almost cocky adolescent view. But mm-hmm. at the time I wrote Interview with the Vampire, certainly I was in a deep despair, and this book is going further on the journey.
Let's clarify what you just heard. The author of the book said that the name of the book is Interview with a Vampire. He said that at the moment of the interview. But now if you ask her, she will say is Interview with the Vampire. So, when is she lying? I believe at the present moment. Since the book's name is Interview with a Vampire, it makes sense that the movie also is Interview with a Vampire. or it was supposed to be. And you will see this next, confirmed by Tom Cruise.
This film is the eagerly awaited Interview with a Vampire. I haven't really shown you the best part of Interview with a Vampire.
You know, I use the books as a reference for me, and you know, you have to read them, especially Interview with a Vampire, because it's from Louis' point of view. You have to read it very carefully to find the clues to who Lestat is.
Some of you that have less trust in their own memory could trick themselves into believing that it was in fact Interview with the Vampire from the beginning. But what about the Google algorithm? You cannot involve that into a conspiracy, but you can involve the actors and the author in such a plausible conspiracy. And the conspiracy could be part of the answer to this issue. The reason that I insisted so much on Interview with a Vampire is because it offers all the proof we need to believe that the Mandela effect is real. That being both a virtual change, but especially a physical change in our known reality. Now, for those that did not see the movie, we will look now at some other examples of the Mandela effect. Do you remember the line from Disney's Snow White when the evil queen is talking to the mirror? It's a very famous line from the Grimm Brothers novel, which is translated in many languages, and we all know what it says. As you can see, both the beginning and the end are missing in this line. Now, if you said, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of them all?" then you are in my reality. Let's watch now the new version of the Disney movie in comparison with the correct one, and you will also be amazed to see that the ending is also changed.
What wouldst thou know, my queen?
Magic mirror on the wall, who is the fairest one of all?
Say what?
Famed is thy beauty, majesty, but hold, a lovely maid I see.
This spring.
Mirror, mirror on the wall. Who's the fairest of them all?
Snow White.
What?
What?
Snow White.
So instead of mirror, mirror on the wall, we have magic mirror on the wall. And instead of who is the fairest of them all, we have who is the fairest one of all. It's a double change. You could say they're playing with us, they're trying to make fun, and this whole thing was done as an amusement prank, but it's not the case, because they take it seriously and they actually claim it was like this from the beginning. The skeptics, which is someone that did not study the phenomenon enough and so didn't find an example relevant for him, could say that people are under the impression that it was Mirror, Mirror because of this movie, recent movie with Julia Roberts. But the question is, why would Walt Disney change the line in his movie? He didn't, because there are too many people that remember this particular Disney movie with Mirror, Mirror. The original line from the Grimm Brothers novel suggests to me that I remember correctly the ending of the Disney's line and that it is changed. Now let's verify with the YouTube algorithm what our collective memory says about this famous mirror mirror line. If we search for mirror, we have mirror mirror, fairest line, the first option. If we search magic, we have nothing. And if we search magic mirror, only the third and the fourth options are from Snow White, the new version of Snow White. The same conclusion is to be drawn here. There are a lot of people searching for Mirror Mirror, very few for Magic Mirror. Now let's take a look at a commercial from the 70s and the 80s. I wasn't even born when this commercial was running, but and probably most of you will not remember this commercial, but you don't have to have known this ahead of time to realize that a change has been made. It's a commercial for cereals, and the famous line is "Give it to Mikey." We will first watch the full commercial, and then a parody after the commercial, in which Mikey is played by Michael Jackson back in the 70s.
What's this stuff? Some cereal. It's supposed to be good for you. Did you try it?
I'm not gonna try it. You try it.
I'm not gonna try it.
Let's get Mikey.
Yeah. He won't need it. He hates everything. He likes it. Hey, Mikey.
When you bring life home, don't tell the kids it's one of those nutritional cereals you've been trying to get them to eat. You're the only one who has to know.
A new cereal Mom got you. It's supposed to be good for you. You want to try it?
I'm not gonna try it. You try it.
I'm not gonna try it, no. Hey, let's get Mikey.
Yeah, he'll eat anything.
Here, Mikey. I guess Mikey didn't like it.
So why would Michael Jackson change the line from the commercial? Of course he didn't. That was the commercial in the 70s and in the 80s. And the change was made now. How else can we verify that? Well, it doesn't make any sense to say he hates everything. Why would you give it to Mikey if he hates everything? But if he eats everything, then you can eat it also, because he ate it and he's fine. That's the whole point of the parody. Again, it's a very small, you could say, unnoticeable change. It's like someone is trying to play games with our minds. If you're not convinced by this, I would say you have to be more open-minded. And you have to be aware of the cognitive dissonance factor. Now we are going to take a look at more examples. The first one is the Berenstain Bears versus Berenstain, which is, from what I see, it's what started the whole Mandela Effect movement, because there were too many people that remembered the Bernstein instead of Berenstain. And very important with this example is the physical proof. Just like an interview with a vampire, there are tangible physical proofs, like toys, that shows the old version. And we will take a look at some of these.
Try syncing this up. Berenstain Bears. Berenstain and Bernstein. Look on the label right there in the orange. It says Berenstain Mama Bear. Here's again the doll right there in the orange. You can see Berenstain Mama Bear. And this is mocking the moon landing. Like it's a joke, you know. Everybody knows about the moon landing, right? And so these are just pictures right from YouTube of people selling, you know, their vintage Bernstein. Here it is, new Bernstein plush bear, B-E-R-N-S-T-E-I-N, burnt right here, vintage lot. And then here is, people have probably seen this, the billboard article. It says Bernstein Bears. So here's another one, excellent lot. Bernstein Bears. It's a lot of vintage bear toys. Blah, blah, blah. You can read it, pause it, whatever. It says on the tags, Bernstein. So they didn't get all of them changed somehow over to Berenstain.
This is one of the most easily verifiable Mandela effects, because you have to think this through. Nobody in their right mind would fabricate a toy and then by accident or deliberately put different names on the same toy. Now here I was talking about the Sara Lee commercial from the 80s. I didn't know it. The line is, nobody doesn't like Sara Lee, which is a double negation and normally wouldn't be used. But there are a lot of people that says that it was actually, nobody does it like Sara Lee. I have to say, I'm not so sure about this one, because I found a commercial from the 60s, 70s, in which it is a clear line, nobody doesn't like Sara Lee. So this one could actually not be a Mandela effect. This is why it is important to carefully study the Mandela effects to make sure it is actually the case, not just a misunderstanding. However, the next three movie lines, I would say, clear the case for the Mandela effect. The first one is a very famous line from Star Wars. I wasn't a fan of Star Wars, but again, there are a lot of people saying the same thing about this famous line that they remember to be different.
And there's this line that comes out. Blank. I am your father. What is the word that goes in the blank? My own son's name is Luke. I say this line all the time to him. Right? It's Luke. I am your father. And then Luke goes into this thing. No, that's impossible. And it's great acting. Awesome drama. Anytime I'm away from that kid for more than a day, as soon as I see him, I go, Luke, I am your father, right? It's because it comes directly from that movie. How can you forget that? Now I'm going to play you the movie, and you can listen to what's said, and then your jaw can hit the ground, because the Mandela effect has affected one of the greatest dialogue exchanges in movie, cinematic, entertainment history. And it's been changed.
If you only knew the power of the dark side, Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
He told me enough. He told me you killed him.
No, I am your father.
Not true. That's impossible.
Search your feelings. You know it to be true. Luke, you do not yet realize your importance.
No, I am your father. It's gone from Luke to no. It's a small thing. But like I said, my own son's name is Luke, and I say that to him all the time. It's what I remember. It's what I hear everybody say they remember when you ask them to do the line.
The dialogue that said, Luke, I am your father, I said to myself, he's lying. I wonder how they're gonna play that lie out.
Jedi says, Luke, I am your father and your uncle.
I figured it will be more efficient to let you hear other people's testimonies on the Mandela effect. As a parenthesis, it's not hard to see that in this movie, Luke Skywalker is actually a picture of the Antichrist, and Darth Vader obviously of Satan. And his reaction to finding out the truth is the tricky part. It is actually a pre-programming of people to believe in him and to accept him as a good savior. Almost every movie in Hollywood has such subliminal messages. This is why I'm not surprised that there are so many Mandela effects related to mainstream productions. The second line is from the movie Field of Dreams with Kevin Costner. In this case, again, I don't remember the line, but I don't need to remember it correctly. There are other people that remember it. When we will get to the section on possible causes of the Mandela effect, you will clearly see why I have no problem in believing that this is a deliberate change in the movie. The central idea of the movie is that Kevin Costner's character heard a voice that determines him to build a baseball field. Now let's watch a scene from the movie that leads us to the Mandela effect.
But the fact remains is that you don't have the money to bring the mortgage up to date, so you're still gonna have to sell it. I'm sorry, Ray. We got no choice.
Ray. People will come, Ray.
Ray, when the bank opens in the morning, they'll foreclose.
People will come, Ray.
This is what convinced him to build the baseball field. Because if people came, his investment would be recovered. Before I show you what the voice told him in the new version, I can't help it to notice a very interesting synchronicity, as it is called. The same actor that told you to search your feelings because you know it to be true in Star Wars just said the original line that now is changed from the movie Field of Dreams. Of course, as I mentioned before, I don't believe in these so-called synchronicities, but we will discuss this in more detail later. Now let's listen to the voice.
If you build it, you will come.
Annie, what was that?
He will come? Who is he? Or who are they? When we will look at the cause of the Mandela effect, I think we will find out the answer to these questions. The third line from these very convincing movie lines is from the movie Gone with the Wind from 1939. Of course, I don't remember the line. I barely watched the movie partly when I was young. However, in this case, you only need common sense to figure it out that this is clearly a Mandela effect and a change had taken place. For a better understanding, I will leave someone from an older generation to explain this.
Ray! 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 Hugo!
shall I go? What shall I do?
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
Went to Gone with the Wind, the most famous scene. Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn. I had to see if they changed that. You know, the most famous line in our cinema's history. And Rhett Butler still says, frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn. But what I immediately noticed when watching that scene was the lead-up to Rhett's line. When Scarlett O'Hare comes rolling down the stairway and she asks him, wherever shall I go? Whatever shall I do? That's what she asks him before he tells her he doesn't give a damn. You know, he's fed up with her. And of course, today in the new reality, her lines have changed. To where should I go? What should I do? Now, one of my friends on Facebook said that's the knockoff budget white trash version. Now, that might be a couple lines you might hear in the TV show Cops. Where shall I go? What shall I do? That's not what she said. It's not what I remember growing up and being forced to watch Gone with the Wind with the family. And, of course, we're all waiting for that line at the end. You know, we couldn't swear as kids. And so usually someone would imitate Scarlett, wherever shall I go? Whatever shall I do? And someone would imitate Rhett, frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn. And of course, in this version today, she says, where should I go? What should I do? And it's shorter, just like the scene in Star Wars is shortened. And getting away from Gone with the Wind for a second, I said in my last video about Star Wars that scene is shorter than it was. And it's the pause after Luke Skywalker says to Darth Vader, he told me you killed him. Obi-Wan told me that you killed him. And there's a pause. Going back to Gone with the Wind, some of you will remember, where should I go? What should I do? And, you know, online, some people say, whatever shall I do? Wherever shall I go? That's not correct either. It's wherever shall I go? Whatever shall I do? In that order. And today, with the Mandela effect in charge, it's where should I go, what should I do? And many millions of people will remember it the way I do.
Now that I bested your appetite, I will give you another famous movie line that is now changed from the movie Jaws. There are three guys on a boat trying to catch the shark. And after the first encounter with the shark, the character played by Roy Scheider says to the captain,
you're gonna need a bigger boat.
You see, it makes absolutely no sense to say you're gonna need a bigger boat, because they were in it together and he was the one paying for the mission. They had a big fight in the beginning of the movie in which he convinced the captain to take him along. So glitch has taken place because the line was, we're gonna need a bigger boat. Another claimed Mandela effect is supposed to be Procter and Gamble. I'm not sure about this one, but I do have to admit the fact that Procter is pronounced Proctor. So was it written Proctor with O? Because it was definitely pronounced Proctor in both realities. The same with the show Sex in the City. Now it's called Sex and the City, and I'm not sure what the name was before, but I have to admit that it doesn't sound right, Sex and the City.
Please welcome the stars of Sex in the City 2. Please welcome the stars of Sex in the City 2. Please welcome the stars of Sex in the City 2. Sarah Jessica Parker, Cynthia Nixon, Kristen Davis, and Kim Cattrall.
And, you know, you just kind of feel Sex in the City fever all over New York. Yeah. And, you know, you just kind of feel Sex in the City fever all over New York.
Do you mean like another show like Sex in the City, or do you mean another Sex in the City?
Well, I'd like another Sex in the City, personally.
Another show like Sex in the City? Sex in the City, or do you mean another Sex in the City? Another show like Sex in the City? Sex in the City, or do you mean another Sex in the City?
Where did that come from? Now that I've seen this, I'm pretty sure it was Sex in the City. There are much more such glitches in our reality, called Mandela effects. I will end this video with a little compilation with more of them, but for now I think it's enough for us to get an idea and move on to the most important thing, which is what determined me in the first place to hold this speech and to make this video, and that is the explanation. Before we go into the real cause of the Mandela effects, what actually produced them, I will leave you with a quote from Nelson Mandela and its meaning.
There is nothing like returning to a place that remains unchanged to find the ways in which you yourself have altered. He has this completely switched around. It should say, there's nothing like returning to a place that is changed to find the ways in which you yourself have not altered. And that's what we're studying. And he has it completely switched around. You know, is this... Where did this quote come from? What is he talking about?